This Week in Radio Tech, episode 284, is brought to you by the Axia Fusion AOIP Mixing Console. Fusion, where design and technology become one. By the Telos HX6 talk show system, perfect for request line callers and serious newsmakers alike. Six lines and two digitally clear Telos hybrids in one rack unit, the Telos HX6. And by Lavo and the Crystal Clear Virtual Radio Console. Crystal Clear is the console with a multi-touch touchscreen interface. Hey, who's the engineer on your Christmas list? Perhaps it's you. From network and audio analysis tools to weather stations, cameras, and stocking stuffers, Chris Tobin and Kirk Harnack check out some gift ideas for us engineers to put on our wish lists. Hey, welcome into This Week in Radio Tech. I'm Kirk Harnack, and oh, I looked all over the house and I can't find my Santa hat. You know, I've got a lovely Santa hat, just flops over at the top just right, and I can't find it. But I've only got a few more days. What's today? December the 10th, and we're heading into Christmas, December 25th. And this show is about Christmas gift ideas for engineers. Things that they like and that they won't tell you, or things that they didn't know they wanted, or things that, you know, they're just maybe too shy to say. We're going to try to point some of them out. It's Kirk Harnack here in Nashville, Tennessee, at my home office and the headquarters for This Week in Radio Tech, I suppose. And Chris Tobin is with us from New Jersey. Hello, Chris. Welcome in.
Well, hello. I'm doing well. Actually, you know, it's a great day today. I enjoyed a personal-sized pizza in the park, 62-degree weather, sunshine, blue skies. And I look at the calendar and clock. I'm like, wait a minute. This is December 10th. I must be in a different time. It doesn't make any sense. So either this means that we're going to have a nice, comfortable winter, or we're in for a doozy in January.
Ah, well, yeah. But, you know, can we really predict any of that?
Well, no. It's just something we like to say and talk about, and people make money doing that.
A butterfly flaps his wings in China and changes our weather here, and there's a little bit of truth to that.
Well, you know, if time travel existed, boy, would we be in trouble.
Yeah. Well, we could go forward and see what the weather's going to be. We'd always be right. Didn't Marty McFly do that?
Yes. Or you could be the doctor and travel back and forth.
There you go. Yep. Sure. So this episode, Chris Tobin and I, two, erstwhile traveling, mumbling engineers, we're going to hand out advice on Christmas gift ideas. And Chris, I had the chat room open earlier. Let me see if I still do. Yeah, okay. Chat room is open. If you want to be in the chat room, you're watching live, go to gfqlive.tv and give yourself a name. You can be anonymous if you want to, and join the chat room and tell us where we're going wrong and tell us what you'd like to perhaps see for a Christmas gift. Well, I have a few knickknacks around here. Chris has some ideas as well that he's been working on for Christmas gift ideas for engineers. I know we're hard to buy for. I mean, look. It's all, Chris, I don't know about you, but for me, my wife, it's always a problem what to get me, because I want weird things that she wouldn't really know how or where to get. And so I end up getting, you know, socks and soap and some cufflinks, things like that.
I'm more than happy with just Christmas dinner. That's fine. No need to shop for me. I'm fine, because I've just got the strangest, you know, things that I like and toys. You know, I'm a kid at heart, and unfortunately I'm always looking for things that make me laugh and have fun. So it's just a nice dinner together and I'll be happy.
You know, I'm really the same way. Get me a card, give me a hug, and I'm really fine. That's all I need. How about a day of relaxation? I'm not a sports fan at all. I'm really not. But look, let me just sit back on the recliner and watch a football game and bring me some ham, you know?
Yeah, I'll enjoy a good game of, you know, a curling match and soccer. I'm happy. Since baseball season doesn't happen right now, there's no baseball. But, yeah, that's me. I'm more than happy to do that.
Well, you know, hey, our show is brought to you. Let's get our first commercial done, and because, you know, these people make it possible. Speaking of Christmas, I mean, these people give all year round. I'm talking about our sponsors and on this show, Axia, also Telos, and also Lavo. They're our sponsors. They have been for quite a while. And it's their participation, their financial participation in the show, and you listening to their ads that make the show possible, because it does cost money to do this show. All right. And our first sponsor is, in fact, Axia. And the folks at Axia have this console, this delicious, beautiful console. It's called the Fusion, and it is just amazing. What a gorgeous piece of equipment. From a mechanical point of view, you see it there on the screen. This console has got an anodized aluminum top. Every piece that you touch there on the top is metal, and the double anodized aluminum is pretty amazing. You know, you may have owned consoles in the past that had Lexan on the top to make the markings, you know, to mark the on and the off and program buttons and maybe mark next to the faders, you know, mark your DB marks next to the faders. The things, the text and the markings that have to go on a console so you can have some idea of what you're doing there. Well, on most consoles, these are printed on Lexan. The predecessor to the Fusion console, the Element, these were on Lexan, but this Lexan was actually embedded about a 32nd of an inch down into the metal. They actually routed out the metal and cut the Lexan out the exact same size. I mean, to the thousandth of an inch, as the depression in the console. So you actually cannot, on the Element console, cannot get your fingernail under that Lexan. We have to take it off at the factory if you send it in, you need something changed. Well, on the Fusion console, the folks at Axia did something different. They decided to laser etch and double anodize. That means there's no Lexan. There is absolutely nothing to wear out marking-wise on the top of this console. Now, speaking of wear out, what about the faders and what about the buttons? Well, the faders are these ingenious faders that are, I don't know how you describe, their grade or quality. We've tested them for well over 100,000 operations. And instead of the fader, it's called the tang. It's the part that sticks up out of the fader and that you plug the knob onto on the top. You know, those things on so many consoles, those things wear out. Well, hey, I own some Axia consoles that use the same fader. And they haven't worn out. They haven't even gotten sticky or hard to move yet. They just feel great. They feel like new. Well, these faders on the Fusion console and the Element, and actually all the Axia consoles, instead of going down from the top and having an open area in the top of the fader where dust and dirt, dander, spills, all that kind of stuff can just go right in there, the tang actually wraps around the side. It's kind of a C shape, and it goes around the side. It enters the fader body from the side and slides up and down that way, see? And by doing so, you don't have the problem of gravity, at least, pulling, you know, dirt and dander, fingernail stuff, hair, no matter, you know, whatever you've dropped on the console won't go down into the fader. It'll just fall right off the side of the fader because the fader doesn't have an opening toward the top. It's on the side. This is an ingenious design, and it's one of the things that makes an Axia console last and last and last. Now, if you ever do want to or need to rebuild the faders, they sell a fader rebuild kit. I personally don't know of anybody that's used one, but you know, we have them. There's also the on-off buttons. These buttons are incredible. They call them aircraft grade. What does that mean? I don't know exactly. I do know that the button design itself was tested by our engineers at Axia. They actually built a little robot with a finger and it pushed the buttons. And after 100,000 times, they said, okay, we're going to buy these buttons. The buttons are just extraordinarily reliable. And of course, they're all backlit with LEDs. So you don't have the light bulb burnout problem with those. Really built well. On the new Fusion console, everything that you touch is metal. Well, okay, the fader top knobs aren't. The button tops are plastic. But the top of the surface, as we said itself, double anodized aluminum, brushed aluminum. The overbridge is metal. The end caps now are metal on the Fusion console. And the bull nose, the part that's in the front, you know, the part that takes all the abuse of disc jockeys' wrists sitting on them, that's made of metal too. So the whole thing is metal. It is so strong and firm and sturdy. The frame upon which it's built, you can stand on this thing. And, I mean, you can actually get up on the console and stand on it. You know what? It's just supported, you know, by the ends in a drop-in situation, and it doesn't bend. Not that you can see anyway. And maybe if you had a micrometer, you could measure it. Just really super, super well built. I love this console. Besides all the mechanical good stuff, it really has features that help the operators, like these beautiful sharp OLED displays that show clearly the fader number, the fader source, the pre-fader audio level coming into the fader,
And also, if you have a backfeed going on, it shows meters for the backfeed. So you say, yeah, I'm sending you audio. You can see it right there. So really well built and just full of features that you want to see. It is the, I mean, the grandmaster daddy audio over IP audio console, the Axia Fusion. And, you know, I'm talking about it like it must be this big honking console. And you can order a great big one. But you can also order one that has, I think, 4 faders, 6 faders, 8 faders. You can order a small one as well, any size in between. You can totally customize the modules that go in it, from intercom to buttons to, you know, just buttons that do things, to telephone modules, to fader modules, to the monitor module. It's just a terrific deal. Check it out if you would. Go to the website, telosalliance.com, and look at the Axia Fusion audio console. Amazing. All right. Hey, Chris Tobin, welcome into the show. And you gave us a report already on the weather. You said it was a beautiful day there in New Jersey.
Yes, sun is set around 4:25, and there's a Christmas tree lighting taking place nearby in a park. So the holiday season has begun in this area. So it's good.
I'm looking at the security cams here at the Harnack house. Santa provided those last year. And looks like some of them have switched over to their night mode. Others have not. The ones that are kind of behind the sunset have already switched over to a black and white infrared mode. And not all the Christmas lights have come on yet. I can see the garage. Here, tell you what, let's do. As long as we're talking about Christmas presents, flip this around. And I know it's hard to see it. I'm having a hard time holding it still. But there you go. There's 6 cameras at the Harnack household. That way I can see when the UPS guy drives in. See?
This looks like a scene out of one of those spy pictures.
Put the camera
I'm about to see ghosts go to white noise one by one.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
Then suddenly alarms start ringing and the look of panic on the face.
You know, I do. Sometimes I see my wife or my mother-in-law drive up and I think, oh, the front door's locked. Let me just go make it easy for them. You know, they have keys. But, you know, hey, if I can jump up there before they get to the door, great. All that much better. And once in a while, I'll see a deer amble by. I've seen a turkey, too.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. Usually, sometimes I see where somebody left the back sliding door open and one of the cats will get out.
So, a cat's out of the bag.
Yeah, exactly. Well, Chris, how should we do this? We really hadn't talked about a format here for showing off Christmas gift ideas. I've got a bunch here. Have you got a few yourself?
Yeah, I have a list of handy not toys, but handy pieces of equipment for broadcast engineers to use. And this year has been a year of craziness for me, so I've focused on some simple test stuff with AES and a couple of data-related items for files, for PDF, for manuals, and things of that sort. So, and then there's also the comical, like, sonic screwdrivers for those of you who are sci-fi fans and stuff like that. But that's for another part of the show.
I want to hear about that. Well, get started with something meaty. What's a good? All right, boys. Any engineer's going to like this.
All right. Well, I'll tell you, this is what I like. It's from OWC, the Other World, Computer Company, I think it's called.
Yeah, yeah.
MacSales.com. Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a 2 terabyte hard drive, a little portable one that I've been using. I'll mention that here too, for the last year or two, and on it is every conceivable piece of documentation that I have come across in various projects, everything. And it's just become unwielding at times because it's it's a square little portable guy. And so I came across this Envoy Pro Mini. It's a 240 gigabyte SSD USB stick.
Whoa.
Yes, it's a USB 3, but it'll run in USB 2. It's slower speeds, but it's an SSD on a stick.
And it's 250 gig.
Yep. It's $179. It's powered by the USB bus. And it's pretty cool.
But instead of flat normal flash technology, you said it's an SSD.
And that's correct.
And I'm not sure the difference in those. Sometimes I've tried to see the difference, and I've been told that there isn't a difference. But I got to believe that there is a difference.
There is a difference. I couldn't tell you the details to the differences at the moment, but there is a difference in the way the mapping and the memory is managed. But it's faster, and it's pretty cool. I just thought it was like, wow, you know, an SSD in the palm of your hand, or actually between your fingers if you really want to spin it around. But it's just handy.
And that SSD, which is not a drive size SSD, but a flash drive size, like something like this.
It's a thumb drive. You know, yes, absolutely. It's
a thumb drive that's 256 gigs.
Right.
Now, and it came from OWC, Otherworld Computing, MacSales.com.
Yes, that's right? Correct.
Now, I want to give you the flip coin of that suggestion. Here's what not to buy. Okay. This is a flash drive that is reportedly 1 terabyte.
Really?
And it was $22. And it doesn't work. So
when you say it doesn't work, does it save anything? It just sits there.
Well, it worked perfectly for a few days, and then it just you plug it in and it doesn't even recognize that there's something there.
Well, that's because it's taken your data and sent it somewhere else. Got it.
Okay. Well, you know, it came directly from China. It came in the postal service from China. I bought it from one of those really, really, really cheap companies. It wasn't GearBest, but it was one of those very inexpensive, low-price, super discount Chinese direct sellers, or you know, direct aggregators that aggregate products from a number of companies. Who knows? This might be a third shift product. But it's a terabyte. I wish it worked.
So I guess what you're proving is that you get what you pay for.
Yes, get what you pay for. All right, let's. I want to ask Suncast in just a couple or 3 minutes to have the first video ready. We have a video that's a great Christmas gift idea. That it's called Simple Circuits, but I gave him the YouTube link for that. Let me show you a couple things, or at least one thing that I think is a good stocking stuffer, and I find use for this all over the place. But, you know, I mean, an engineer can buy this for himself, but I had it handy, and I have used these in so many places. Now, this has got to be the super discount model that, you know, you can't buy one cheaper. This is from Rolls. They're known for making inexpensive broadcast gear of a semi-professional nature. It's powered by a 12-volt wall wart, but this is the Rolls Pro Match. So it's like the Henry Matchbox, but this is the cheap version that I can't vouch for how great it is. I just know that it does work. So yeah, if you have a piece of semi-pro gear that has, you know, RCA unbalanced connections on one side, and you need to interface that to professional broadcast gear that needs a +4 level and balanced ins and outs, probably on XLR connectors, then this box will do it for you.
I've used those. Pro-Mesh. I have used them. They do work very well.
That they do. And with, you know, look, with today's analog technology and IC chips, unless you mess up the design, it's going to perform fine. And I don't think they messed up the design.
No, I've used them in remote locations, on remotes, that is, outside broadcasts, and they've worked really well. The one thing with consumer side, the consumer part of that, is keeping the consumer cables short. So, you know, if you're doing something from a laptop to that to convert audio levels, you know, don't do a 50-foot run of unbalanced wire into it. But, you know, short,
exactly.
5-foot.
You want this to go next to the device. So if you've got a VCR, a CD player, whatever it may be that you're interfacing to, I tell you what's fairly common, or what could be common nowadays, is let's say you've got an inexpensive little audio mixer, maybe a Behringer or a Mackie mixer, and you need to interface that into a more professional broadcast environment that's, say, audio over IP. Let's say it's a live wire system, and that audio over IP system is going to have nodes that want to have balanced inputs and outputs. This is your box right here. That's how you get those things to talk to each other.
Yeah, no, that works well. They make a couple of good products, and they're inexpensive, and they do the job. You know, don't expect it to manage, you know, getting banged around and you use it in a hostile environment, in a broadcast environment, but definitely can be used for ad hoc stuff and get away with it just fine.
And tell your whoever's buying you your presents, maybe you can send them a link. Most any broadcast equipment dealer will sell this. I don't know if places like Guitar Center sell them, but any broadcast dealer, BGS, BSW, Giesler, Dale, Pro Audio, all those guys. They'll, RF Specialties, they'll all have it. All right, Chris, you got something next for us?
Yeah, you know what? I meant to run down and get my bag that I had some of them that I could show and tell, but I'll talk about
it. Okay. Well, I'll take over for a minute, and you can go get your bag.
You want to do that? Yeah, let's do that, because I looked down and I said, hey, I didn't grab the bag. Okay.
I've vamped,
and I'll be back.
I got a couple of things. All right. This one, this is an IP camera. Now, there's all kinds of IP cameras available, but you find more and more uses for an IP camera. In fact, this one's made by Ubiquiti at ubnt.com. Ubiquiti. This one's about $120. And it'll run over, it takes power over Ethernet. So you just run your Ethernet cable in there. They provide you with the power supply to insert power, onto the Ethernet. And then you plug it into your network and you run their program. And there's some other programs that are compatible that can let you see the video from it. I think you can see it with a browser as well if you browse into the unit. Well, cameras are probably going to continue to get cheaper and cheaper. We just on Facebook yesterday, our friend, former co-host here, Chris Tarr, posted that he's using a pan-tilt, I don't think it's a zoom also, but maybe it is, pan-tilt camera from D-Link. And it's very inexpensive. It gets very mixed reviews. Chris said he likes this pretty well, and he provided a picture from it. But it's on Amazon for about $65. It's a D-Link. I want to say it's got the number 600 and L in it, but I could be wrong. But look for a D-Link pan-tilt IP camera for $600. And it has a Wi-Fi interface if you want to use that. It also has a wired interface. So you can plug it in and watch it remotely using, especially you can overcome router difficulties and firewalls. They offer a D-Link cloud service that lets you easily watch it without having to do a lot of router configuration. So, hey, these remote cameras are cool, and you don't have to spend $200 or $300 on them anymore. You can get something that's at least decent, apparently for $65 on Amazon. All right, I have another couple of stocking stuffer ideas. Don't throw away this idea, because I really appreciate this myself. I'm always running out of batteries here at the Harnack house. You know, I've got a 5-year-old son, right? And there's always, you know, 3 toys needing batteries. Well, you know, for years and years, it seems like this Rayovac brand was always considered second rate. Maybe it still is, but that's not how I view it. They do advertise lasts as long as Energizer. These are Rayovac alkaline batteries. I think part of it was for decades, it seems, everybody else was making alkaline batteries, and Rayovac was making super heavy-duty batteries that were not alkaline. I could be wrong about that, but that's just what I seem to find in the store. Well, now Rayovac, and for some years, they've been making alkaline batteries, and inexpensive. I want to say I paid about $14 for 60 batteries. 14, 15, but maybe 17, I don't know, at Home Depot. Just picked these up and restocked my battery supply. But you can get one of these, and boy, it will fill a stocking. Engineers, well, you know, love-hate relationship with batteries. You hate it when you don't have them and you need them. And so here at the Harnack house, we got a ton of them. Now, smoke detectors. I know you've got smoke detectors in your house. Everybody's supposed to have those things nowadays. And here at the Harnack house, we've probably got 6 or 7 smoke detectors. There's one right here in this office. And, you know, you're supposed to change the batteries on those things twice a year. Well, I found, at least for me, the best way to get these batteries, 9-volt batteries, is in a box like these. These are ProCells. There we go. From Duracell. Yeah, Duracell ProCells. And I know there are plenty of engineers out there. You already know to buy them in this box. They're cheaper this way. You can buy these on Amazon as well. There's probably other places too. But I started seeing these in the professional environment of a TV station. They had until they went to rechargeables, they were buying a lot of these boxes for the wireless mics and the wireless IFB systems for the talent. And so I've seen these boxes around ProCell. Okay, I'll go look at those. So I forget how much these cost, but man, I buy one of these boxes I buy every 6 months, and I go replace. There's a dozen of them in there. I go replace the 9-volt battery in all of the smoke detectors around the Harnack house. Good stocking stuffer. You put these together, and you've got what, about 6 pounds worth of stuff to go into your stocking. All right, so that's what I've got so far. Is Chris Tobin back yet?
I am back.
Hey, good. All right. So I went through some stocking stuffers and an IP camera while you were gone, the Ubiquiti little IP camera. But I mentioned, Chris Tarr mentioned one on Facebook yesterday that he's pretty happy with, and it's on sale right now at Amazon for $65. It's a kind of a standalone pan-tilt camera that also does Wi-Fi or wired, and it's a D-Link product. It's gotten mixed reviews. Some people say they hate it, but from their reviews, I think they were expecting it to do things that it doesn't promise. So take that into account. But Tobin says
what was the model number of that?
You know, I'll go look that up because I should provide that. So while you're talking about yours, I'll get the model number.
Excellent. All right. What I have here is a Wardbeck Systems Audio Bit Spitter, not splitter, spitter, ABS-1. Now you may say, why would I want this? Well, you know what? Nowadays, and as you know, if you're a fan and product user of Axia products, you know that there's some products that don't have analog audio inputs and outputs anymore. It's strictly AES or live wire. So in that case, you're going to need something like this to generate AES signals and testing. It's a handy little box. It has sampling rates of 48, 44, 1, 32K, and external clocking, if you like. And then it gives you audio output levels on tones for 400 hertz and 1 kilohertz. And it's minus 20, minus 12, and 0 dB full scale, which translates to, let's see, minus 16 dBU on the minus 20, minus 8, minus 12, and then plus 4 dBU on the 0 dB full scale. A little history of this particular unit. In a previous employment, I worked at a facility where we had to relocate our primary studios for a period of I think 12 hours or something to that effect. And part of the operation at the top of the hour and the bottom of the hour, a tone had to be placed on the air to time hack to let everybody know what time it was at the top and bottom, and the announcers would, you know, so coincide with that. However, since we'd be off-site, physically off-site, and would not have our usual time tone generating equipment, believe it or not, the output of this guy at 400 hertz through a relay, every time the relay, which was on a portable master clock from ESE, at the bottom and top, when the relay closed, the audio tone out of this went through the relay, went across the program mix bus that I created with the mixer and the temporary studio we had, and we had time tone twice an hour for 12 hours. Now, you may say that's nothing, but the reality is we had to set the studio up days in advance to make sure it was going to work so that we could not have a failure. Now, you may say, well, it's a big deal. It's just a simple, you know, couple hours overnight. Well, when you're a news operation, today's a normal day. But what if there's a breaking story? Now what do you do? You're off-site. You got to make sure you can still manage the breaking story situation, which would mean we probably would stay at that off-site location longer than we had planned. So this box was running for close to a week prior, generating tone twice an hour as we did all the tests offline for our 12-hour or 18-hour temporary off-site location. So it's a handy little box, and it's really rugged and works well. That's just a little tidbit for fun, something you can do with this little guy if you had to in a pinch. And, you know, I do some crazy things from time to time. So I have something else.
Yeah.
AES. So one of the things you know, people always overlook, and I actually loaned this out to a friend of mine recently. He was grateful because he's like, I couldn't believe I didn't realize what the problem was. Another whirlwind product. I talked about one earlier. AESDA, nice little box. A lot of folks out there are probably familiar with it. If not, it's something very handy. You know, it's these things that you don't realize. It's worth the investment. It's a couple hundred bucks. I'm not sure. I have the prices somewhere, list prices. But it's, you know, depending on what you want to call cheap and, you know, expensive or inexpensive. But the point is, it gets the job done, so you minimize the, you know, the chaos of somebody yelling and screaming and saying, why couldn't you figure this out earlier? This box has been handy. I've used it for a lot of things. It gives you the digital monitoring, so you can tell if your AES signal has errors in it or not. You can also decode that with the level meters, see the audio levels, and know what's exactly going on. And the nice thing is it does balanced, unbalanced. So you have the SP diff, and then you have the standard AES balanced. Very important that you don't mix the two, because SP diff, as we know, is 75 ohms and it's about 0.2 volts peak to peak. And the AES3, which is 110 ohms, is approximately, I think it's, is it 5 volts peak to peak? Or it varies, something like that. So it's, as you can, it's like, you know, it's like prosumer audio. Yeah, there's about a 14 dB difference in level. So it's important to know these things. So it's handy. And you can also get a digital output or analog output by just a flip of a switch on this guy. So it's really cool. It's battery operated, so you can carry it around and do things. Or if you like, there's a wall wart option, and you can plug it in permanently. Now, these are handy little things to have in the kit. Notice there's a handle. There's a reason for that. So take advantage of it. And then there's the other version.
And the name of that again is what? The name? The model?
That is the Whirlwind AESDA.
AESDA. Okay.
Yes. So you can actually look that up on the website.
Well, Chris Tobin is showing off the expensive Christmas items. Christmas
gift.
Well,
this is for broadcast engineers and for things to, you know, to get the job done. You know, if you want your personal stuff, that's between you and your loved ones. I'm not going to get into that. That gets all crazy. It's like the Hatfields and McCoys.
Yeah, I guess it occurred to me we are showing things that some things you would ask the station owner or manager for, and other things that you would ask your family for or your friends. Christmas gifts for engineers. Here's a gift that I always wanted one, and I still don't actually have one that's my own. This one belongs to my employer, but everybody recognizes that is a GoPro camera, and a GoPro camera can be very handy. It's actually pretty small, but by the time you put it in a case, the camera itself, it's got a back on it that provides monitoring, but the camera itself is this big. And they've got a newer model out now that's even smaller, just a little cube. And there's so many competitors now. The GoPro is, seems to be the kind of the standard. I don't know that it's the best. It may be, but it certainly is the standard. Well, engineers, how might you use a GoPro? Lots of ideas. You ever thought about maybe putting one of these into a piece of equipment that, to see something that you can't see? Now, it won't take pictures in the dark, but it'd be interesting to see if this would operate inside a tube cavity, and so you could catch some occasional arcing going on, if you had to. It might be interesting. You can remote control this with Wi-Fi. So there's an app for your phone that you can remotely start and stop this. I did that at the NAB show in Las Vegas last April. We wanted to do a time lapse of people arriving at our booth. And so I mounted this way up high, got a big wide panoramic view of our booth, the area where people would walk from. But the battery life on this thing is only so long. I'm actually a little bit disappointed with the battery life. Maybe I've got some old batteries. But we remote controlled this thing to turn on as people were arriving, and it captured 20 or 30 minutes worth of people arriving. Turned that into a time lapse, and it worked really well. But a GoPro, it's a good idea. As they're available anywhere from about $300 to $400 depending on which model that you get. There's all kinds of accessories. One of the more popular accessories among tower climbers. Do you have a tower climber on your list? Is the helmet mount. So there's great videos on the YouTube with tower climbers with a GoPro on their helmet, and so they can show you climbing the tower and fixing whatever it is that they're fixing, and describing the work as they go. In fact, we've had some of those videos here on our show with John Hettish. He was a guest on our show, and he uses a GoPro all the time to document what he's doing, document it for his customers, and to make interesting YouTube videos. So I think a GoPro is a good Christmas gift. Chris, what you got?
Another nice Christmas gift could be a jumping drone. The folks from TWiRT that make the drones of all various types, they have a new one that's got two wheels and it actually doesn't fly. Well, it sort of jumps if you choose. They make it jump. The jumping sumo. It's pretty cool. I've seen videos of it. It's got a camera. And the nice thing about it, the best part, is a smartphone control, your iOS phone. So you can use your phone and you can watch the video and move around. It's pretty cool. It's about $120, I think, at the popular places like Best Buy, Brookstone, things like that. Yeah, the jumping sumo.
We're talking about gifts for engineers, gift ideas. Have they been naughty? Have they been nice? the folks at Telos have put out a Santa video that's kind of fun. We'll put a link to that in the show notes, or it's on YouTube. If you look up probably Telos and Santa, or if you look at the Telos Facebook page, it's there as well. And as long as we're talking about Telos, let's hit them as a sponsor of the show. By the way, right after we get back from them as a sponsor of the show, I'm going to show you the gift that has caused so much buzz on Facebook. Friends and family, jealous engineers have been saying, "I want one of those." That's coming up right after this announcement about the Telos HX6 telephone talk show system. Hey, a lot of people get started with a new talk show around the first of the year. They're dedicated to saying, "Hey, we're going to have the mayor on every week, or we're going to do a medical talk show and bring some doctors in every week." Well, the Telos HX6 is an inexpensive and yet very, very high-quality way to get into doing talk shows on a broadcast facility. By the way, you can use it certainly whether you're a podcaster full-time, whether any kind of content creator, if you're creating live content, and certainly radio and TV stations are good candidates for this, but not just limited to those. So the Telos HX6 is a six-line phone system that has two telephone hybrids in it. What does that mean for you? What does six lines and two hybrids mean? Well, six lines means that you order from the phone company, or you can create yourself through an asterisk PBX. You can create a hunt group, or what people often call a rollover. And so if you're new to this, there's some documentation at Telos, and the Telos engineers can give you some ideas about how to do this. Again, either from the phone company, from Vonage. If you're a Vonage user, you can easily create a hunt group by subscribing to several Vonage lines. And you can also do it with inexpensive voice over IP lines that you would set up yourself, especially if you have an asterisk PBX, which, by the way, you can run in a Raspberry Pi if you want to get really inexpensive about it. Well, the Telos HX6 phone system takes these six phone lines, up to six phone lines coming into it, and you can then have those lines roll over. So you just give out one phone number, and people call that. And if you know that first line is busy, it rolls to the next line and rings that one. And if that line's busy, it rolls to the next one and rings that one. And if all six are busy, or however many you've defined in your hunt group, then the caller gets a busy signal, and you know they're going to have to call back. But that's how radio stations have done this for years. Well, what makes the Telos HX6 cool is the telephone interfaces are built right in. You just plug their phone lines, either from the phone company or from a PBX or from an analog terminal adapter, if you're coming from VoIP lines, different ways to get POTS into this thing. And then it has two telephone hybrids. Now, what does that mean for you? Well, two telephone hybrids built in means it's easy to do conferencing. So you can have an expert guest. Let's say here, I'll do the numbers again. Let's say you make a hunt group of five lines, and you have one line that's not part of that hunt group. It's just a line that comes in. Well, that's your line where you put your expert guest on. So you have the mayor call in, or you call out to the mayor, to a doctor, to an expert in whatever subject you're talking about. And that expert guest stays on that line for the whole show. And then your listener callers call in on the hunt group, and you can have that expert guest on all the time on their own hybrid. So their quality is always good, as good as it can possibly be from a telephone. And then you put your callers on one after another. They can hear that expert guest. They can hear you, and the expert guest can hear you and the callers. Now, you may think, well, that sounds pretty complicated to set that up in my audio console. Well, here's something else that the HX6 gives you that's very cool. The HX6 will work with any console, any audio console, as long as it has at least one mix minus or auxiliary bus. And in fact, if you really have to, if you just want to have just the announcer's microphone to feed the callers and the expert guest, well, you can do that too. You can make that work with a console that doesn't have any other provision for handling phone calls because internally in the HX6, the two hybrids can conference to each other. And that means, without getting into too much detail here in the weeds, that let's say your expert guest is the mayor. The mayor can hear the callers. The callers can hear the mayor, and the HX6 will mix in your microphone with all that. Now, if your audio console offers mix minus, then you've got that too. And if you want to have complete control, you can have two mix minus buses from your console, and the HX6 will work with that as well. Point is, lots of different scenarios, lots of different ways to make this work really professionally for you. The other cool thing about the HX6 is each hybrid has its own audio processor from Omnia. That means that the callers' voices are going to sound as clear as possible, even clearer than you might hear them on an ordinary telephone, either a cell phone or a regular pickup dial phone. The Omnia processing really clarifies the callers' audio and makes it so that everybody can hear each other with as much clarity as possible. So, that's the sales pitch. It's really a wonderful device, like fifth generation of Telos hybrids are in there. An enormous amount of engineering went into it, and yet the cost is really, it's the same as the venerable, no longer made, Telos 1X6 plus another hybrid. So take a 1X6, add an inexpensive hybrid to it, and you've got the cost of the new Telos HX6. Check it out if you would at telosalliance.com. There's a picture of it. It's a good box. We use it at our radio stations. It's used at radio and TV stations all over the world. And thanks to Telos for sponsoring This Week in Radio Tech. All right. Chris, I've got this. I've teased it pretty big, this thing that everybody wants to have. And I'm embarrassed. I don't have a long enough wire, so I'm going to unplug it. I've got a little battery in it, so it holds the time. It's a clock. Yes, that's a clock. Kirk brought a clock to school. And this is the boy, it's hard to see with this light, isn't it?
It's very shiny.
It's very shiny. It's an analog clock that shows the time in hours, minutes, and seconds on voltmeters. And the voltmeters have the kit includes stickers. There you go. There's a picture of it. The kit includes stickers to make new faces on the clock. And the electronics really is already built for you. You don't have to do it. It's based, I believe, on Arduino, but it's a custom made little circuit board in there. And most of the kit putting together is, you know, just assembling the case, which is a little it takes some finessing. And then a fair amount of the time is spent refacing the meters, because they come as just inexpensive meters with a big V on them, but they send you these stickers to put over the meter face, the original meter face, and give you hours, minutes, or seconds. And you plug the thing in. You can put a battery in it if you want it to hold the time while it's unplugged. And then it's got a big knob in the back that you turn to set the time, forward or backward, fast or slow. And it is called, what is this thing called? We had the picture of it a minute ago up there. It's from Wicked Device. That's the name of the company that that makes it. And it's the Angular. Angular clock kit from Wicked Device. You can buy this at various places around the internet, various DIY places. If you pay more than $60 for it, then some places selling it for more than the suggested price, which is fine. But you know, if you want to find that $60 is the going price. And I mentioned this to my wife. I said, hey, honey, here's something that would be pretty cool. I'm telling you, it wasn't a couple weeks later that it was sitting in my lap. Oh, man, I've got a project for tonight. And put it together, and it worked right not out of the box. It worked after I got done with it. How about that? Which was almost out of the box.
That's very nice.
It will be the talk. I mean, it's I put it on Facebook. I made a little movie of it on Facebook that shows the second hand, you know, ticking up. And I've gotten so many comments, people saying, I got to have one of those. So great gift, $60. They're on Amazon too, as well as other DIY shops.
So there you go. Very nice. Well, see, I have some more fun stuff, so we're going to go with the geeky, techie stuff that all of us probably enjoy in some part of our psyche, but just don't tell anyone about it. So if you're a Doctor Who fan, and those of you who are Doctor Who sci-fi fans can appreciate at least a Weeping Angel's coffee mug that changes from a one angel to another when it's hot and cold. Or that's a nice little set. Or you can, keeping along on those themes, get a TARDIS mug. That's the TARDIS. That's the time-traveling device of the Doctor. Or if you're a Marvel comic person and keep things in the hiding, you can also get a S.H.I.E.L.D. watch. That's a very nice decorative-looking thing. It's subtle. It's quiet. You could be in a meeting and just simply, you know, cross your hands while you're talking and show off your S.H.I.E.L.D. You could do it that way. And then, let's see. Oh, then if you're like somebody who's just strictly non-sci-fi and just want to be in the IT crowd, you could get a mug that I believe when you heat it up, have you tried turning it on and off?
Have you tried turning it on and off? Yeah.
So, you know, when you get that IT call, maybe what you do is fill the mug up, head over to the person with the IT issues and just place the mug on the desk and wait for them to read it. Pick it up, sip it. Yes, and then just be on your way.
I want one that says, let me Google that for you.
That's true. That would be a good one, yes.
I'm sure they're out there. I'm sure if you Googled, let me Google that for you, coffee mug, you would absolutely find it.
Absolutely.
So, Chris, I've got some rapid-fire things to go through here, but I welcome your comments on any of them, if you've used them or not, if you can recommend them, or you know a good place to buy them. Sure. All right. Thing number one, Google Cardboard. Have you played with a Google Cardboard yet?
Yes. Yes. New York Times sent out a piece for people who are subscribers.
I heard that.
Yes.
This one, I had to buy the extra super large size one, because I have a Samsung Galaxy Note 4, which is kind of a super large size phone. But it fits in there like that, and then the front closes, and then you open the app that is the cardboard. Well, I forget the name of the app, if it's cardboard or if it's something else. If you've used this, you know what I'm talking about, and you probably know more about it than I do. I used it for about 20 minutes and thought, okay, interesting science experiment. Not going to wear it all day. Not going to really get, you know, tons of movie enjoyment or anything like that. But hey, it's it's got a place in technology, and the whole Oculus thing is going to, I think, you know, could take off. It's a little bulky in the front, kind of weighs the front of your head down because you're putting your phone in front of your head. But there you go.
That is very strange, putting an RF device closer to your forehead. Oh,
that's true. But you know, the way you navigate is you actually, you know, you want to reach up and swipe the app, but no, you don't do that. You actually turn your head to look at different icons in the app.
Right.
And then there's a button over here on the side that you flip to tell it to do this, do this, do this, do this. So.
Very nice. So you're talking virtual reality. You don't have to leave your home.
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, there's all these different kinds of virtual reality. There's augmented reality, and there's virtual reality. Augmented is when, you know, when you use the camera in the phone and you shine and that displays to your eyes. So you're seeing, you know, you're seeing the world around you as if you didn't have this on. But right. Then the app is adding things to that, like identifying. Now, that was the idea behind Google Glass, right? You wear Google Glass, you go to a cocktail party, and you say, there's Bob Williams, he's the CEO, and there's his wife, Mary. Oh, and there's the CFO of the company, and you may want to introduce yourself to the sales manager. Yeah, that's what the promise of Google Glass was supposed to do for
offer you, yes. Well, you know, yeah. You could also look back in time and say, well, you know, Surrogates, the movie, 2009, Bruce Willis talks about these things. Rather than waste your time running about town, you just get a surrogate to do it for you. And you watch through the augmented reality, virtual reality, or some type of connection to your brain stem. So it's pretty good stuff. So I see the direction we're going in. This is good. I'm looking forward to it.
Now, let's change direction on this. This is it's another thing to look through. I've always found many engineers, can't speak for all of them, but many engineers like beautiful mechanical devices. And here, for example, is a kaleidoscope. And oh, cool. this was made by a friend of mine and given to me. And it is just beautiful. It's made from a kit. But, you know, I think a gift like this has sat on my shelf for, probably 20 years now. And every once in a while, I'll take it out and I'll just have a look and delight my eyes with the enjoyment of the kaleidoscope patterns. And you know, it's got some brass and polished metal. And I just think stuff like this, I, as an engineer, I really enjoy, beautiful mechanical devices that are kind of old-fashioned. I like that. Now, if it was a cardboard kaleidoscope, I wouldn't be so interested. But this is nice. This is not something that you throw away. It's very nice. Yeah. What do you think?
I like it. It's nice. Now, I'm curious, what does your son think of it?
I don't think I've shown it to him. I need to.
Today I had lunch with a few folks, and we were talking about a gentleman I was talking with. His 69th birthday was this week, and he was fascinated by how things have changed in technology and social media, and everything is so instantaneous, or, you know, instant gratification, whatever you want to call it. He goes, I've observed many things, and one thing I've observed is we've become less interested in imagination, creativity, and just, you know, talking about it. Because I can't seem to get people to talk anymore. And then when I do talk about something, say in this case your kaleidoscope, they look at me as if, what are you trying to speak down to us? What is this? What are you doing here? I'm serious. And you know what? When I thought about it, I said, you know, that's interesting. Because we're working with a couple of folks, you know, quite younger than I am and have a different perspective of, you know, the past and where things are going in the future. And sometimes I slip into my, you know, my tinkering mode and I start talking about, well, what if we did this? What if we did that? And they look at me like, why would you do that? And I'm like, well, maybe because the outcome could be something more interesting, maybe do more for us. Maybe it's something we should be thinking about because it just helps to expand our, you know, understanding of what it is we're working on. Didn't go over well. So I'm curious if that particular item that looks like stained glass and lead beading on the sides is
exactly
something. Yeah. It would be interesting to see how your son reacts to that. Given the other external stimulus that he gets from other things in his current.
Oh, you know, and he gets plenty of iPad and cartoons. And you know what's interesting? that I find that he's watching a lot nowadays is he's watching YouTube videos. There's a YouTube Kids app, which is really good because you can trust that that you know stuff he's going to watch is good stuff. Seems to be curated, and there are so many videos that are parents and children playing with toys. They're basically showing you how to play. They make up scenarios for little characters to interoperate, to talk to each other, fight with each other. If it's a war game sort of thing, one dinosaur eats another guy, but he watches this and then he goes and he plays with his own toys and makes up similar stories. In fact, we put a story like this on YouTube. He wanted to do a movie and I wanted to do the movie with him. So he did a movie using his toys and making up various, in every scene, the good dinosaur beat the crap out of the bad dinosaur.
Good versus evil.
Yeah. It wasn't just dinosaurs. It was also rescue bots. I was wondering, now, how's he going to get rid of the bad character, each time they fight? What's going to be the end? And we were filming it on a table. And the ending of every fight was exactly the same. The good guy basically pushed the bad guy off the table.
Wile E. Coyote and the Roadrunner.
Yes.
Over the cliff he goes. Yes.
Exactly.
Every episode, no matter what happens, that little puff.
On the subject, though, of I was at a flea market about a month ago with my wife in Brooklyn, actually. And they had some art displays. Some artisans were displaying their wares. And the most fascinating one for me was where you take these old items that are salvaged from old buildings, for example, old pieces of light stanchions, sconces from the wall, and you remake them with typically a lot of them are made with these Edison filament bulbs that have real fancy filaments in them, right? And this guy was doing a great business, and to me, repurposing this old stuff that's beautiful, and yet it was so much of it was put together and built in the 20s, 30s, 40s, maybe early 50s, and then we got in the space age and the plastics age, and the drywall age, right? And so a lot of this stuff went away. But now, when it's salvaged, you have artisans that make beautiful art with it, and I love that stuff. I would love to enjoy something that's 100 years old and is doing at least something. It's either looking beautiful or it's providing some light or something like that. Well, back when I got my degree in meteorology, I became very interested in these inexpensive weather stations that people used to put in their homes. And I probably bought a dozen of them on eBay at various prices, 10, 20, 30 bucks or so. I almost never use them actually, but I look at them. There's four more of them right now over on a bookcase here in the office. So that's an idea. If you can scrounge eBay for cool things. And as a weather nut, to me, this is a very cool thing. It shows temperature, humidity, and barometric pressure. And that's what they all did. They were tons of these made in all different kinds of cases with different themes and looks. Designs to enhance any decor.
Those are classics. They make you think. They're great.
Yeah. Now, on top of the house, I've got a perfectly modern weather station that reports in, well, in fact, this would have been a good thing to, is the cable long enough? It is. Okay. So here's the modern equivalent. And this was I want to say, $150 bucks or so. This and the sensors that go on the top of the house. And this is tied into a repurposed TP-Link brand little travel router that's flashed with totally new software that makes it do all kinds of weather functionality. So a lot of engineers are weather nuts as well. It's a science. And so weather-related paraphernalia can be pretty interesting as a gift to an engineer. That one's made by Ambient Weather. Hey, if you just go to your local Sam's Club or Costco, big box store, you're going to find weather kits for in the range of 70 to 100 bucks or maybe 120 bucks. And a lot of them are wireless weather stations. Look for that, a wireless weather station. You put a sensor up on the house as high as you can, and it reports back to a panel that you can see in the house, and it records all that too. It does a little bit of weather prediction, you know, based on changes in barometric pressure. And I like to be remote from the house. I was in New York checking how much it was raining back here at the house. It rained an inch and a half one day when I was in New York. So I think that's a good gift, and typically under $100 at the big box stores.
Well, it's handy because it does two things for you. It's, you know, for your personal enjoyment and edification, but also if you maintain transmitter sites or rooftops and antenna structures or tower structures, knowing what the weather conditions are going to be from day to day, that's actually very handy. You can map it and understand what's happening. So I like
it. Yeah. You know, some of those are Ethernet connected, and a lot of the weather stations have an indoor temp and an outdoor temp reading. So if you put one of these at a transmitter site, let's say you have a mountaintop transmitter site. Well, that's very interesting to know the weather at the mountaintop. And since the sensor, you know, the panel is typically indoors, it has an indoor temperature reading. That's also typically where the barometric pressure reading is too, because it's about the same indoors as outdoors. Point is that if you get one that can be remotely accessed, then you can monitor easily the temperature in the transmitter room. And you may be doing that already, but this is just another way to get it done. And monitor the temperature outside. Ooh, it's a 72-mile-an-hour wind up there, and it's minus 12 degrees. I better bundle up. So,
yeah, Chris, it's very handy.
Have you got something else for us, Chris?
I don't have any little geeky stuff. I just have another tester, if that's okay with everybody.
Oh, that's, yeah.
Again, these are things that help you get through the day and other stuff. This one's helped me a lot. It's actually saved my I won't say this bacon thing again, but that's this is a classic. Let's see if we can make this look good on camera. It's a Fluke product, and it's called a Cable IQ. And you can use this to determine whether your Ethernet cabling systems are proper or whether it'll pass 10/100 gig E, voice over IP protocols, things of that sort. Let's see if we turn this on, what happens. Is the battery's charged? There we go. Okay, good. So this basically is the unit in my hand. And then you separate the end cable end tester and you plug it in. And I've used this on many occasions to certify cable installations I've worked on. And you can also connect it to a computer, USB, and print out the results or store them if you'd like. And I actually have compared this to other systems and had companies come in to certify a plant. And I said, oh, yeah, let me do my thing first. I'm going to put my notes together, and then I'll come back and see what you come up with. And believe it or not, we came up with the same. The only difference was in price. So it's very handy, and a lot of times, believe it or not, I helped build, was it 2 years ago? I think it was 2 or 3 years ago. Help a friend build a radio facility, and we had four studios, cable runs, the whole bit, Cat 5 everywhere, and the offices as well. And about 3 or 4 days later, after he moved into a new facility, he called me. He says, "We're getting all these problems with the computers. I don't understand this. They log into the network. They're doing fine. All of a sudden, they drop, and people are telling me they things just aren't right." So we come in with the tester, and I remember reading a white paper somewhere, and they said 98% of Ethernet infrastructure problems can usually be traced to the endpoints. In this case, would be the wall plates or connectors. So I said, let me try this theory. So we went from each cable run from the desk cable, the connector, back to the switch point to the patch panel, and we started qualifying the cables. And we discovered that the cables that were crimped were not properly crimped or crimped well enough. And the crosstalk on some of those cables, the near end crosstalk, was enough to cause standing waves, because remember, it's an RF signal, on the wire right at the connection point. So the computers, various computer Ethernet cards, some could handle the reflected signal, others couldn't. Some of the laptops just collapsed completely. Desktops sort of ran the gamut of almost all of them worked fine, and just occasionally some didn't. And it was interesting. All we did was take a crimping tool, went in, crimped the connector tighter, and it actually solved the problem on about 90% of the cables. A few of them were just done wrong.
The
color code was totally off. But a lot of them was just the crimp was enough. But without this tester, you'd never know it. You'd be chasing your tail thinking, oh, it's a bad cable. I'll pull it off out of the cabinet. We'll just do another cable from the computer, the rear of the computer to the wall and be done with it. A lot of people overlook that infrastructure, the wall back to the switch room, could actually be a problem, not the short run or the last mile, if you will, the last 10 feet.
Now, that tester tests very dynamically, right? I mean, it actually puts some signal in the cable.
It's not just a DC continuity tester. No.
Okay.
This little guy, it does a number. I mean, I tried that just to make sure I wasn't, you know, spending $1,300 for nothing.
Because no, you can get I never have been able to buy one of those. I've had to depend upon myself or a contractor to do the connections right. But I have found mistakes that I've made using the DC type testers, and you can buy those for $7 or $10 or $15 at the most at various places. And they're just testing for the proper wiring and make sure you've got DC continuity and nothing. You know, you don't have a split right. pair where you shouldn't, or a disconnect where you shouldn't. And I would have to guess that, you know, a certain percentage of your problems could be found with those. I certainly have. But if you have a cable that passes the DC, doesn't imply for certain that it's going to pass, you know, that your twist is right, for example. If you untwist it too far and crimp it, it can pass DC, but it may not pass a gigabit, or maybe not even 100 megabits.
Right, because remember, you're talking RF. Okay, you're talking RF signal. If you understand RF, and many of our audience do, you know what happens when you have a poor connection or just not right. What happens to RF? The other thing that the Fluke folks do is they have a fox and hound, if you want to use that phrase, you know, tone testers, a tone selection. This is interesting. This device will do standard, straightforward tone. You know, we're all accustomed to. Oops, wrong way. And then it does what they call IntelliTone. And let's see.
Okay,
so you say, well, that's a funny, you know, funky tone. That's pretty cool. Actually, it is. I tested this. I put the tone on a pair of wires in a bundle that was probably 6 inches across. And then I went and started sniffing out the tone in the rack room. And believe it or not, the IntelliTone, I was actually able to find faster than the traditional Fox and Hound.
Ah.
And it was more accurate. And it has to do with the way that what you're hearing, those tones, it's actually a DC, like a code, and it actually is able to figure out what's going on. And I was just sitting there going, wow. Now, the reason I'm pointing this out is not just for the fun of it. In several occasions, I've managed, maintained, and helped install audio over IP infrastructure. And the density is getting higher and higher as the months go by. These tools, trust me, It is a godsend when it comes to troubleshooting a problem after you've installed, say, several hundred Cat 5 cables on a distributed audio plant over, you know, audio over IP, and you have audio issues and clocking, and, you know, everyone looks right to the computer. Did you reboot the computer? Is the driver up to date? It's like, yeah. But what about that one piece that's in between all of these things that nobody really looks at? Oh, right. There's the Ethernet switches, the Ethernet cabling. This box can also, you plug it into an Ethernet network. It can tell you what ports on the switch are not active, so you can manage what's going on. There's a few things it does. It's pretty wild. But I used this in an Axia installation years and years ago. This is what introduced me to this. I've had this for a long time. And it worked. It made sense. I was able to actually troubleshoot a few things. And I was like, wow, because the IT guys I was working with immediately looked at the computer. They said, oh, your driver is the issue, not this, that, the other. And I'm like, no. This doesn't make any sense. This behavior doesn't follow drivers. And sure enough, it was cable related. It was cable related. But, you know, these are the things I'm talking about because, you know, the density of what we're doing nowadays with Ethernet is just out of control. So, you know, between AES and AOIP, these tools are essential. So, you know, granted, it's not something you get a gift from your wife. But
that tool from Fluke is called a what?
It's called the Cable IQ Qualification Tester.
There you go.
And this particular kit, yeah, I think it's list like $1,300. Well, I picked this up secondhand from somebody. What was it? It was an IT company. They were making changes and upgrading equipment. And a buddy of mine said, "Hey, we're getting rid of a lot of stuff. If you want, we're just selling things. You know, pick a number, and if it's worth it, we'll take it from you." I'm like, "Really?
Yeah.
Okay." So I got it real cheap, and it has worked really well. I've kept it up to date, and it's interesting. The DC testers are, as you point out, ideal for certain applications, but you just need to remember Ethernet is an RF signal. You've got to treat it that way. Same with bending the cable, tying it together. Yeah. You don't tie wrap it so that you can see the impression of the tie wrap, you know, the teeth. There's a lot of things. Well, Steve Lampen, if you ever read any of his papers, I will tell you that probably 90% of the papers I've read from him, I've run into about 90% of those issues, and he was right.
He knows cable, and we ought to take his advice too. And you're right that we can think a cable is good, and you get a funky problem, and you spend all your time, money, and energy solving, you know, trying to solve the wrong problem, and it turned out to be the cable. So Yeah. Hey, we're gonna take a quick break and be right back with our last items of the show. You're watching This Week in Radio Tech, episode number 284. It's Kirk Harnack and Chris Tobin. We're just kicking back this time, talking about gifts for engineers. We haven't talked about gifts for naughty engineers, and maybe we just don't have time for that. We're talking about gifts. Hey, maybe gifts that you ought to ask your general manager for, or maybe gifts that you ought to ask your family for. That's what we're talking about. Our show is brought to you in part by our friends at Lavo, L-A-W-O, Lavo. They make audio consoles, and they make some really big audio consoles. So if you've got a big, you know, truck, a production truck, if you've got a live mixing venue to take care of, maybe an enormous house of worship or a television production facility, check out those big consoles. But if you've got a radio station or other audio content creation facility, Lavo has got a couple of interesting consoles for you, and one of them is the Crystal Clear. It's a virtual radio mixing console. What does that mean, a virtual radio mixing console? Well, you see on that picture right there, the person's finger is touching a knob. That ain't a knob. That's a screen. That's a touch screen. In fact, it's a touch screen that will allow you to do multi-touch, up to 10 finger touches at once. Now, I couldn't do that accurately myself, but I can certainly handle, you know, moving a couple faders up and down myself. So the Crystal Clear console, the concept is you've got the hardware unit that sits in a rack somewhere, and this is where your audio inputs and outputs actually connect to your microphones, analog and AES audio inputs and outputs. And then it's also got an Ethernet connection that will give you audio over IP via the Ravenna standard and AES-67. So you can connect it to all other AES-67 compliant devices over the same network. It's got a couple of power supplies in there as well. And all the brains of the mixing, all the presets and things that you save and your shows, they're all saved in this box. What about controlling it, though? What about having a console to touch? Well, that's what the Clear part is, the Crystal Clear. That is an app that runs on a PC. It runs in a Windows environment. It takes the entire screen up, though, so you think you've got a console in front of you. And they've designed the buttons and the knobs to be the right size to accept your fingers to touch, move things up and down. And the other thing that they can do, because it's running in software, and everything is, they don't even have a physical surface to deal with, is that all the buttons can be contextual. So that means if you have a disc jockey that, you know, doesn't quite understand how to run a regular board, this board could very well be a lot easier for him. Touch the button, and what pops up are options that just have to do with what you're doing right there. Touch a mic button, and you get mic processing or mic gain setting. There's an auto gain for microphones. You can have your guest talk into his microphone, touch this button, and the gain of the preamp is automatically set so that you don't have to worry, is this guy going to be really loud or really soft? It's already set for you. So you can run your faders at kind of a normal level. So many features are just built into this thing. What you'd expect, actually, in a modern DSP-based, software-based console. As I said, multi-touch, a very intuitive graphical user interface. There are three stereo mixing buses. There's Program 1, Program 2, and a record bus that's built in. Integrated pre-fader or preview is built in. You have scene presets. So if you have a morning show that has different requirements from the midday show or a weekend sports show, you know, just touch a button to bring up the scene, bring up the number of mics and the other inputs that you need there. There's precision PPM meters that are built in, both Euro style and US style operating modes for fader start or button start. Because, you know, over in Europe, they do things a little differently than we do in the U.S. And it's what they're used to. It's what we're used to here as well. A beautiful large time of day clock that stays accurate to NTP server time. Support for guests with talkback. So you can, you know, let's say you're doing a talk show and you need to tell the host, hey, we need to wrap it up right now. Just touch a button, whisper into your microphone, and it comes out in just that one person's headphones. So he knows, hey, got to wrap it up. 24 sources are available. Any 8 can be on the faders at the same time because it's an 8 fader console. Plenty of room to put your fingers on. It looks good. It feels good. And if this is an intriguing idea for you, I wish you'd check it out. Go to Lavo, L-A-W-O, Lavo.com, and go to Radio Products and Radio Consoles, and then look for the Crystal Clear console. On that same page, there's a video with Mike Dosh explaining how the Crystal Clear console works and why it might have some benefits for you. Thanks, Lavo, for sponsoring This Week in Radio Tech. Hey, it's Kirk and Chris. We just have a couple of moments left together, and then we're going to leave you. And Chris, I wonder if you had a final tip or a final gift suggestion. I have just one myself.
Oh, goodness. No, I don't. I don't have any. I ran out. That's
fine. Nope, no problem. Well, let me ask you, if you were a good engineer, would you like to receive this? This is a Sea Crane Skywave radio. Now, yeah, I'm an engineer. I'm a radio geek. But I just, I love having a couple of, or three, or 10 radios sitting around. And the Sea Crane is really beautiful. Bob Crane of the company was our guest on the show one time. And you know what's amazing about this radio is that it actually has the ability to receive AM.
And I'm also a certified aircraft mechanic. So I meant to be. Oh, there's another story. We're pulling out of Afghanistan, Kabul.
Okay, so I'm picking up an AM station down here in my office surrounded by electronics. And this thing is very sensitive. It has AM, FM, weather band, aircraft band, and short wave. It also has a, even though it's a little tiny, electronic radio, it has an audio filter in it. You can set the audio for on the AM and short wave bands for 6 kilohertz of bandwidth, which is, kind of normal voice quality. If you've got some interference going on, you can narrow that to 3 or 4 kilohertz. And if you really need to, you've got maybe a lot of noise or strong interference, you can even set that down to a 1 to 2 kilohertz filter. Now, your audio is not going to sound beautiful, but it's going to get rid of noise from noise sources and interfering stations. FM, AM, weather channels 1 through 7, the air band from 118 to 137 megahertz, and also shortwave all the way up to 26 megahertz. So does a lot of cool stuff. I really like this. I keep it handy here at the desk. I've used it often to check stuff, listen to stuff, see what's going on here and there. And you know what? When the internet goes out, this still works. It's a Sea Crane Skywave, and it is on Amazon, for example, for about $90. And $90 is a very typical price for a little shortwave radio like this. Take some AA batteries, and it also has a USB input. If you want to power it from a, your cell phone's charger, you can power it that way too. I recommend it. Chris, are we done? Have we filled our stockings yet?
Yes, no, that's a great one. Sea Crane does some great stuff. Yeah, I still have my little portable Sony SW100S. It's a AM/FM shortwave portable radio. It flips open. It fits in your shirt pocket. It's pretty cool. It's very old. It still runs, and it's got an external powered antenna. So I actually unspool the wire, plug it into the side, and place the antenna outside the window. So it's pretty cool. But it's, anyone who's a shortwave enthusiast will know that one. That was a classic portable shortwave radio, the SW100S, including the ANLP1, which is the loop antenna, powered loop, active loop antenna.
What was that? Remember the Sony radio that would pick up AM stereo?
Oh, yes. I had one of those too.
I thought it was the SRF-100.
SRF-100, that's correct.
Okay.
It's a little gold one, yes.
I thought they were silver looking.
Oh, silver gold looking. I got to remember. I still have that.
I was looking for some on eBay, and almost every one of them that you find has got some kind of damage. The metal was fairly thin over the speakers. And a lot of them with dents, and I would love to. That's the first radio I ever heard AM stereo on when we made stereo the AM station in Kentucky I was working at. So,
yeah, that would be. I think that I had that radio and the Sanyo, the boombox Sanyo with the detachable speakers.
Oh,
that had Sequam and the independent sideband known as Con.
Yes.
Yep. Yeah, I did both formats. I had stations I worked with did both formats of the AM stereo encoding.
Oh, I'm not sure that we ever closed the loop on the camera, camera. Did we?
No, you were going to look for the model number.
I found it here. Let's see, where did I put it? Here it is. It's a D-Link wireless pan and tilt. Not Zoom, pan and tilt, day-night network surveillance camera. It's the model number is shown here is a DCS 5009L, That's a lot to remember. We'll put a link in the show notes. But I don't know how long it'll be on sale, but it's $65 on Amazon. And again, mixed reviews, so you know, you may or may not be real happy with it. Chris Tarr says he loves it for what he's doing with it now, and he's going to buy more of them. But for $65, seems a little hard to go wrong. You do have to have Java or a plugin in your browser to make it work. Same for my as with my home security DVR, so it's really no different than that. So, and there are plenty of apps for smartphones that you can go watch it with. So I'll put those in the show notes. I'll put as many of these items as I can in the show notes, and we'll get them up there, and hopefully in the next day or two, and you can go review those, all the gifts we talked about.
Nice.
Chris, thanks so much. Thanks for being with us here and taking an hour out of your day or more to talk about Christmas gifts.
Yeah, no problem.
You know what? There's one more. I left it over to the side here.
But wait,
there's more. Now how much would you pay? I actually gave this as a Christmas gift a couple of years ago. Let me stick it together here real quickly.
It does require assembly.
Well, just a little bit.
There are small objects for children, so beware of that.
It's one of these. Now.
Yes, that's a very good radio.
You recognize that? Yeah.
Oh, I do, yes.
I what I don't understand is how... Well, look, I haven't done measurements or anything. I have talked through repeaters with this. This is a, I guess you pronounce it, Baofeng?
Baofeng, I believe, is how people pronounce it, yes.
Baofeng. They make a huge array of handy-talkie, small two-way radios. You'll see them anywhere from the manager and the department managers at a Walmart store. You'll see them carrying... these around, typically they're single channel or two or three channel. You'll see ham radio people with these. This thing was, I want to say, $36. It may have been $40, but it was under $40. It comes with a charger, a charging base, and I think I paid a little extra to get a programming cable for it. And you can get some free software. You can program it from the front, but it's a pain. But you can get yourself a repeater directory book like this one from the AWRL. And then you can go to town programming it and carry it with you. And I love it. I mean, how can you go wrong for for $40? And it does work. And it doesn't feel like a cheap piece of plastic. It actually feels really solid. I think they've done an amazing job. I don't know how they do it. So the last idea, and I'll put that in the show notes as well, the Baofeng. This one says a professional FM transceiver, so it must be professional.
Yeah, I believe that model meets part 90, I think, the new required, 12.5 kilohertz split.
It does. Yeah, I think it does. All right,
yeah,
folks.
I programmed about 36 of those things.
Oh, did you?
A friend of mine's engineering firm got a contract for a local commercial entity, or actually it was a nonprofit, I think, and they purchased something like 35 of these things for, I think it was like $200. $150, with antennas, charges, the whole bit. My buddy calls me up, goes, "Okay, I've never seen these things before. I don't know what they are. We're building out their Wi-Fi antenna system on the rooftop. We're doing things, but these things I have no idea. And the software, nothing makes any sense. Can you, take a look at this?" So I go over to his office, the shop. I look. I'm like, "Oh yeah, I know what these are." Because can you program it? I said, I pull out my cable, my software on the. I have a laptop dedicated just to my two-way radio stuff. I said, "Sure, let's go." And you make one profile, and it's like an Excel spreadsheet, and just pop it in. Next one, next. They're not bad. I mean, they have some limitations, depending on how goofy you want to get with two-way radios. And I sometimes get a little deep into the weeds on them. But for the cost, I know a friend of mine, he buys these just for throwaways. He does projects and outdoor stuff. And if it blows up or gets hit by a truck, it's like, so be it. That's what people do with it.
Hey, that's a great use for these things. Movie props. And if they blow up, so what?
Exactly.
But they do make good gifts. And I gave one a couple of years ago to the hosts here on the show, and everybody seemed to appreciate it. All right, we got to go. We have kept Suncast over long enough, so let's let him go. Chris, thank you so much for being with us. We'll have some deep tech talk by next week, but today was fun.
Yes. And the software for those radios is the Chirp software. Dan Planet.
Yeah, Chirp. Yep.
Chirp software.
Seems like I got that for a Mac as well. They have it for a Mac.
I think they do.
I want to say I did it right off my Mac computer. All right. Our show is brought to you by the folks at Axion, the Fusion console. Also brought to you by Telos and the HX6 6-line 2-hybrid talk show system. And by Lavo, makers of the crystal clear touchscreen audio console. Chris Tobin's been with us. He is available on... for special projects, you can probably reach him at support@ipcodex.com. It will cost you, though, because he's a valuable guy. Isn't that right?
Yes, I try my best.
Okay. And me, my bias is I work for the folks at the Telos Alliance and also own part of some radio stations in Mississippi and American Samoa. So I try to keep up with technology by actually doing the deed. Thanks to Suncast for his producing of This Week in Radio Tech, and thanks to Andrew Zarian, founder of the GFQ Network, where you'll find lots of other fine podcasts. And thanks to you. We'll see you next week on This Week in Radio Tech. Bye-bye.